Hello friends, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to start with our daily current affairs. So today you have 21st of July 2021. As you know that these lectures are useful for those who are preparing for the civil services examination, which is conducted by the UPSC, as well as other government competitive examinations, right? You can supplement your preparation with the help of these daily current affairs lectures. Alright, so let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so first news is all about the TIE 10V2FEAL, right? That is basically the high strength metastable beta titanium alloy, right? Which have been recently been developed by DRDO or Defense Research and Development Organization. This alloy was indigenously developed, right? As the high strength metastable beta titanium alloy, which is basically consisting of the different elements like vanadium, which constitute the V, the iron which constitute Fe, okay, and aluminium which constitute Al. So it is, in short, it is known as the Ti 10V 2Fe and 3L. That is basically used on the industrial scale, right, and specifically for the purpose of the aerospace applications, the aerospace forging applications in the industrial level. So it has been developed by the Defense Metallurgical Research Laboratory, which is a premier laboratory which has been located in Hyderabad, right, which is also a laboratory of DRDO. So let us understand about this alloy. So this high strength metastable beta titanium alloy is basically, you know, is already being used by many developed countries, right, in the recent times, and it is basically very beneficial specifically for those, right, specifically for the aerospace industries. The currently used alloy, which is basically consisting of the nickel, chromium and molybdenum, that is NICRMO, would basically replace or would be replaced by this TIE 10B2F and 3L. That means the nickel, chromium and molybdenum would be replaced by the vanadium, iron and aluminum alloy. And this alloy has basically certain more important chemical and physical properties. For example, it has very high strength to the weight ratio, right, which facilitate the manufacturing of, you know, some sort of a components for the aerospace applications, right, which will basically significantly reduce the weight specifically in the aeroplanes, right, and some of the components which may be forged from this alloy, right, for example your landing gear in the aeroplanes, the drop link in the landing gear, right, these basically require the very less amount of weight, but definitely it requires the high strength to the weight ratio. This high strength beta titanium alloy, which is unique in terms of their high strength, in terms of their high ductility, in terms of their high fatigue strength and fracture toughness, all right, which is basically one of the most important aspect of this beta titanium alloy, which make them a very attractive for the aircraft structural applications, right. So here the DMRL have carried out, you know, this raw material selection very selectively, specifically through the thermomechanical process, right, and because of this thermomechanical process, the heat treatment or mechanical characterization would ultimately lead to the development of this special alloy or development of this special alloy with respect to, right, the aerospace industry. So it will be very, very useful. Here the Aeronautical Development Agency, which have identified almost 15 steel component which may be replaced by almost this, you know, the high strength metastable beta titanium alloy. So it will have the huge industrial application, not only in the aerospace industries but also in other industries also. All right, so let's begin to the new news, that is the India's first green hydrogen plant. So recently, right, the India's largest oil firm, the Oil India Corporation, have decided to build the nation's first the green hydrogen plant, right. This nation's first green hydrogen plant will be set up, right, at the Mathura refinery, right, and it basically aims to prepare for the future catering to the growing demand, specifically both from the oil as well as to, you know, to the cleaner form of the energy, right, just like this hydrogen fuel. So here the Indian Oil Corporation have drawn the strategic growth path, specifically which aims to maintain its more focusing area, that is the oil, refining and marketing businesses. Apart from that, it has also decided to basically start, you know, the hydrogen and electric mobility over the next 10 years. So it will be the hydrogen itself will be built, hydrogen fuel itself will be built, right? And it is definitely a cleaner fuel, but definitely its manufacturing process is energy intensive, and also the carbon byproducts is also formed in this process. So definitely you cannot say that is a totally 100% cleaner fuel, but definitely once it is manufactured, it is cleaner fuel, but the process by which it is manufactured, it is definitely have some carbon footprint. So here there are three types of hydrogens. So first of all, the company would not set any sort of a captive power plant for its future refinery or the petrochemical expansion project. Instead, it will basically use this energy from the renewable sources like solar power, right? And here this will be the nation's first green hydrogen unit that would be brought by this Indian Oil Corporation. So hydrogen, right, would be specifically in the three forms, you can say that. First is brown hydrogen. What is brown hydrogen? The brown hydrogen is created through, you know, the coal gasification process, right? And while the process of this producing gray hydrogen throws off the carbon based, but this brown hydrogen basically do not produce any sort of a carbon based. Then you have this green hydrogen. The green hydrogen basically uses, you know, the carbon capture and the storage. So it is basically involved in the carbon storage and capture, right, for the greenhouse gases which is produced in the creation of the gray hydrogen. And the blue hydrogen that we are talking specifically, right, that is basically, you know, uses the blue hydrogen basically uses this carbon capture. And regarding this green hydrogen is ultimately the clean hydrogen sources. It is basically the clean hydrogen sources, right, which will use the renewable energy to create this hydrogen fuel. So it has got these three types of hydrogen: the brown hydrogen, blue hydrogen, and the green hydrogen, right, in order to expand the cleaner energy fuel in the industrial applications. All right, next, the Jeff Bezos, who is also, you know, the chairperson of the Amazon, have completed the new mission in the space, right? Recently you would have seen that the one spacecraft basically reached to the Kármán line, which have been defined as the space boundary from the Earth, that is around 100 kilometers, right, away or the up from the Earth's surface. That basically demarcates the Kármán line. Okay, so recently Jeff Bezos have completed this journey, right, and he has already gone to the space with the team of the four crew members, right, in a rocket which is built by his firm called Blue Origin. So Jeff Bezos fulfilled his lifelong dream of going to the space on 20th July 2021, and that will basically potentially would open the door for the space tourism. So it is basically, you know, a very important step for the space tourism, for the common citizens to go to the space and to experience the space journey. So here the Amazon founder basically spent almost 4 minutes, right, in the space, right, specifically in the reusable rocket which is built by his own firm called the Blue Origin. The ultimate goal of the Jeff Bezos or the Blue Origin is to open the opportunity for the space tourism, as well as to have some strategic goal to build the floating space colonies over the period of the time. All right, so here the journey which have been done by the Jeff Bezos, right, which will basically is most important step, right, it's a remarkable step of the technology, right, the remarkable step by the company called the company which have been taken as the Blue Origin, or the spacecraft which have been taken by the Blue Origin, right, to the Kármán line in that format. Okay, next, the COVID recovery to drive the carbon emissions. So here one study which was published, right? So here the International Energy Agency have shown, right, some study which basically shows that the carbon emissions are set to hit the all-time high by 2023. It is despite of having the COVID pandemic, right, the despite of having the lockdown throughout the world, the carbon emissions are set to hit all-time high by 2023, right? And you know, it is because of the countries are not sincere enough to invest in the cleaner form of the energy, right? So it has basically, you know, compare how the countries have allocated the resources, right, specifically for the recovery from this COVID-19 pandemic, as well as, right, for the basically cleaner form of the energy, or for the cleaner energy project. So it has been compared. So the, you know, the International Energy Agency's the Sustainable Recovery Tracker, which have found that the countries have just invested around $380 billion that have been provided for the clean energy projects, right? And the IEA, or you know, International Energy Agency's Sustainable Recovery Tracker, also tracked down that the countries have allocated more than $16 trillion, $16 trillion specifically, right, in the fiscal support throughout the pandemic. So that is the fiscal support, right? And this fiscal support is not something which is related to the clean energy projects. So what the Sustainable Recovery Tracker is basically is a shocking that the countries are not sincere enough to basically invest in the clean energy projects, right? So here, if all the spending plans, right, were to be realized, right, you know, the IEA or the International Energy Agency has said that the global carbon emissions would hit the record level at 2023, right? So overall, the carbon pollution would be around 3.5 billion tons, right? Billion tons higher than the current scenario, right? And the economies which are basically fighting, or the world which are basically fighting to control the temperature to the limit of 1.5 degrees Celsius, right, because of this Paris climate deal. But according to the International Energy Agency, this is an unrealistic target, right? And here, because of this pandemic, lockdowns and the travel restrictions saw some amount of the carbon, you know, some amount of low carbon emissions from the countries, right? But definitely, this concentration of these global greenhouse gases again started rising, right, and still on the rise side, or still on the higher side. So it has also compared that the developing nations specifically fell, you know it has fell to just 20%, and as the country is basically hit hard by because of the COVID-19 pandemic, right? So overall, the International Energy Agency has said that all countries were basically started missing this opportunity, or this window of opportunity, to divert the public funds to private funds, specifically to the green projects, to the more cleaner energy projects. And instead, these countries are not sincere enough, right, you know, to provide, you know, the funding to the cleaner energy projects that will basically provide, right, the triple benefits. According to the International Energy Agency, the triple benefits in terms of the climatic benefits, the health benefits, as well as the economic benefits, because the climate change, as well as, you know, the environmental degradation, would definitely impact the human health also. So here, the government need to increase the spending and the policy action rapidly to meet the commitment they have made in the Paris Agreement in the year of 2015, right, in order to control the temperature rise beyond 1.5 degrees Celsius from the base year, right? So that is what is the more important, and is also more emphasized by the International Energy Agency in that respect. All right. Next news, cyber crime. So here, the Ministry of Home Affairs, through the Press Information Bureau, have informed that with the increased use of the cyber space throughout the world, right, you know, including the cyber, you know, financial frauds, right, you know, there are certain crimes, or number of cyber crimes, including the crimes against the woman, right, or crimes related to the woman, is also increasing. So it has also related, right, the use of the cyberspace, right, with the use of the cyberspace, and the crimes which are associated, like cyber crimes, the financial crimes, financial frauds, the crime against the woman, which is also on the higher side. So legal scenario is that, as you know, that police and public order is basically are the state subject. So definitely, you know, it is basically given as per the seventh schedule of the constitution, right? And in that respect, the states or the union territories are basically primarily responsible. The states and union territories are primarily responsible for prevention, for detection, for investigation, for prosecution of crimes. So here the most important aspect is that these law enforcement agencies belong to the space or belong to the states or union territory will take an legal action as per the provisions of the law against that offenders, right? So let us understand what measures the government of India have been taken so far. So a central government has initiated lot of measures, like the central government basically supplements the initiatives of the state government, right? Here through advisories, through financial assistance under various schemes, right, in the capacity building also. For example, you have the cyber crime prevention against the women and the children scheme. So here the Ministry of Home Affairs, right, you know, is providing the financial assistance to all states and the union territories under this scheme, that is the CCPWC, cyber crime prevention against the women and the children scheme, right, to support their efforts for setting up of this cyber forensic cum and training laboratories. So under this scheme, the cyber forensic cum training laboratories are basically setting up, right, and it is also started hiring of the junior cyber consultant for the purpose of reducing this cyber crimes throughout the country. And also the most important step is that Indian Cyber Crime Coordination Center or I4C, which basically provide, you know, the framework and the ecosystem for, you know, specifically for the law enforcement agency to deal with the cyber crimes in the comprehensive and the coordinated manner. So definitely, you know, the government has also set up, for example, you might have heard about this portal, that is National Cyber Crime Reporting Portal, right? Reporting portal. So it was launched, right, by the government of India to enable the public to report any incidents which is related to all types of cyber crimes, right, with a special focus on the cyber crimes against the women and the children. So it is one of the important steps that was taken by the Ministry of Home Affairs, government of India. Next, you have the DB, you know, Shikatkar Committee. The DB Shikatkar Committee was basically setting up by the Ministry of Defense, right? The DB Shikatkar was basically the chairperson of this committee, right? And this committee was basically a committee of experts which was constituted by the Ministry of Defense, right, under the chairmanship of the Lieutenant General DB Shikatkar, right? What was the purpose of this committee, which is related to the defense reforms, right? It is related to the defense reforms. So this committee was setting up off in the backdrop of the defense reforms, okay, to enhance the combat capability of the defense forces, to have the rebalanced defense expenditure of the armed forces, right? And what have the recommendations which was given by the DB Shikatkar committee, let us understand. So some of the measures which are recommended by this DB Shikatkar committee is that, first of all, the optimization of the signal establishment. So here it include the radio monitoring companies, right, the corps air support signal regiments, right, the air formation signal regiments, the composite signal regiments, right, these were basically, you know, optimize the signal establishment along across the defense establishment. The second is the restructuring of the repair echelons. So here, you know, specifically in the army, to include the base workshops, right, advanced base workshops, right, as well as the static station workshops in the field army level. So that is to be set up in order to repair the echelons, right? Then redeployment of the ordnance echelons, also to include the vehicle depots, right? So it has recommended that these vehicle depots should be upgraded, should be redeveloped, right? The ordnance depot, right, should be redeveloped, the central ordnance depot, right, in order to streamline the inventory control mechanism with the Ministry of Defense, as well as it has also recommended that the better utilization of the supply and the transportation, you know, echelons and the animal transport unit will be also be done, right? It also recommended that, right, the Ministry of Defense should consider the closure of these military farms, as well as the army postal establishment in the peace locations, right? There was no need of, you know, continuing with these military farms. And it also recommended the enhancement in the standard for the recruitment of you know, the staff and the drivers in the army in order to imbibe certain professionalism in them, right? And as well as it is also recommended, right, to improve the efficiency specifically in the National Cadet Corps, right, which is also the most important component of the defense. All right, next, you have the draft trafficking in the persons bill, right? So here in the coming monsoon session, right, you know, we are all hoping that, you know, the concern which was related to the trafficking in the persons will be resolved by putting off the trafficking in the persons prevention, care and rehabilitation bill 2021, right? This bill is likely to be tabled in the monsoon session of parliament. Now, what was the need of this, the trafficking of these persons, right? You know, the bill 2021, specifically the need is very, very high to prevent and to counter the trafficking in the persons, specifically the women and the children, which are trafficked across the country, across the international borders, to provide certain care, protection and rehabilitation to the victims while respecting their rights, specifically the women and the children, right? As well as to create the supportive, right, environment, like the legal environment, economic environment, social environment for them, right? As well as to ensure the prosecution of the offenders, right, which are matter which are connected to the trafficking. So it's a very, very important, you know, step which was taken by the government of India. So certain key aspects related to the draft trafficking in the persons bill is that, right, the National Investigation Agency shall act as a National Investigation and the Coordination Agency, which will be responsible for, right, which will be responsible for prevention and combating the trafficking in our country, right? Combating and trafficking in our country, specifically the persons, right, and other offenses under this act, right? So here the National Investigation Agency would investigate, would prosecute and would coordinate in the cases of the trafficking in the persons, right, under this act. And the next is the National Anti-Human Trafficking Committee. So here the central government by notification would establish this National Anti-Human Trafficking Committee for ensuring the overall effective implementation of the provisions of this act. So this committee would help in the effective implementation of the provisions of this act for the coordination, right, as needed for the prevention and the you know, countering of offenses under this act. The next is the protection homes and the rehabilitation centers. So under this act, there was a provision to have the protection homes and the rehabilitation homes to enable the immediate and the long-term sustainable rehabilitation to the victims of the trafficking, right? And also to maintain the updated national database to the traffickers. So here that will basically, you know, the concerned authorities would coordinate among themselves and to coordinate the agencies and appropriate governments, and they should also maintain the updated national database of the traffickers as well as other offenders under this act, right? And it is a most important aspect and to enhance the awareness about the provisions of this act. So this is a very, very important, you know, step which was taken by the government of India, which is going to, you know, brought this bill in the coming monsoon session. Okay, constitutional provision, you know, Article 23, which provides, right, that the right against exploitation, right, which is basically related to, right, you know, the bonded labor and basically your child labor, right, which is also not permittable under Constitution of India. Next, the Sarang Helicopters Display Team. So here the Sarang Helicopters Display Team of the Indian Air Force is set to perform, right, the first time at the International Air Show that is going to be happens at the Zhukovsky International Airport in Russia, right? This air show is scheduled to be commenced from the 20th July to the 21st July this year. So this is the first time the Sarang Helicopter Display Team would be performing in this occasion. And this is the first occasion the Sarang team is performing with four helicopters aerobatic display in the Russia, right? Which is basically, you know, the made in India Dhruv Advanced light combat helicopters would also be pressed into the service in the performance of in this international air show. So apart from Indian Air Force, the Indian Army, Indian Navy and Indian Coast Guard also operate, right, these helicopters in our country. Okay, and the Sarang team was formed in 2003 at Bangalore, and it was basically formed in the backdrop of the performance at such type of international displays or international air shows, right? And it was first displayed right, is Beller at the Asian Aerospace Air Show that was held in Singapore in 2004, right? And the Sarang have been represented the Indian aviations at the air shows throughout the world, right? As well as it has also represented the ceremonial occasions, right? In UAE, Germany, UK, Bahrain, Mauritius, Sri Lanka, right, etc. In other countries also. So it is also performing the aerobatic displays at the national as well as the international venues like these air shows. And the team has also taken, the active humanitarian assistance in the disaster relief operations and the missions whenever it was needed. So it was the one of the most important, aspect which is related to the performance of this, the Sarang team specifically, from Indian Air Force perspective. Okay, next. You have the high-speed maglev train. So China has unveiled the world highest speed maglev train, which is basically going to run by around 600 kilometers per hour. So that is the topmost speed, or the train can run up to that speed, that is around 600 kilometers per hour. That is stated to be the world fastest ground vehicle. So this maglev transportation basically is, is in the public debate, specifically in Qingdao, which is a coastal city in the Shandong province of the China. Okay, this project was launched by the China in 2016, right, which is related to the high-speed maglev train. And this project basically was very successful, specifically for the development of this maglev high-speed train or the magnetic levitation, the train prototype, which was designed and developed by the China. And this train is basically expected to achieve around 600 kilometers per hour, the top speed. And this has already conducted the successful trial in the June 2020, right? And this is basically, try to bridge the gap between the aviation, that is aircrafts, right, that we basically use, that runs around 900 kilometers per hour to 1000 kilometers per hour, right, as well as the high speed train. So this train basically bridges that gap, right, of the movement. And as compared to the traditional vehicles, right, which is running on the wheels, this maglev trains basically do not contact with the tracks or the rails, right? These wheels basically, they just lift up and they move with a very high speed, with a very little noise. Okay, next, the Adarsh Smarak. So Ministry of Culture informed the Rajya Sabha about the three monuments of the Andhra Pradesh have been identified as the Adarsh Smarak for providing the additional facilities like Wi-Fi cafeteria, interpretation centers, the bail signatures, right, as well as the illuminations, etc. Right, so here these three monuments that is belongs to the Andhra Pradesh are the monuments at the Nagarjun Konda, that is located in the Gundu district of Andhra Pradesh, that Buddhist remains at the Salihundam in the Srikakulam district of Andhra Pradesh, and the Birabhadra temple at the Lipakshi in the Andhra Pradesh, right? And here the Adarsh Sampark, the Adarsh Smarak scheme is basically was launched in 2014 by the government of India to improve the visitors amenities specifically for the physically challenged. So the scheme basically comes under the Ministry of Culture, Government of India. A total of around 100 monuments was basically protected by the Archaeological Survey of India, which has been developed, right, and maintained as the Adarsh Monument under this scheme, or Adarsh Monument scheme, right? Here the civic amenities are being augmented at these sites, right? The main objective of this scheme is to make the monuments visitor friendly, right, to upgrade and to provide washrooms, drinking water, signage, cafeteria, Wi-Fi facilities, right, to have the interpretation audio video centers, right, to streamline the wastewater garbage disposal, etc., to make them a world-class, the destination centers or the tourist centers for those people. Next, the WHO GMP COPP certification. So a very important aspect is that the Indian Medicines Pharmaceutical Corporation, which is a central public sector enterprise, right, located at the district Almora in the Uttarakhand, have sought, basically, have applied for the WHO GMP, or, basically that certification for the 18 Ayurvedic projects. So that COPP is basically the certificate of the pharmaceutical products, right? So it has been applied for this certificate of the pharmaceutical projects, which is being aligned under WHO. So here the WHO GMP certificate is mandatory for most of the global markets, right? If these companies or the central public sector enterprises, if they want to export these commodities or these Ayurvedic products, they will have to compulsorily get this certificate, that is WHO certification of the pharmaceutical products, and that has been needed in order to export those commodities or those, you know, medicines. So here the manufacturing of the exporting countries must be licensed by the regulatory authority, and that country will also comply with the WHO guidelines. So here the certificate of this pharmaceutical product is a certificate which has been issued, right, in the format and which has been recommended by the WHO or World Health Organization. So this certificate of the pharmaceutical project is issued, right, which is based on the guidelines which are laid down by the health agency, and it's aimed at the diminishing the risk which is inherent in the pharmaceutical production. This certificate basically helps the regulator to ensure that the drugs are consistently produced and are quality controlled before they are leaving the country, right? So that is basically in order to ensure that quality is maintained while manufacturing this drug. Then you have the MLACs to increase the life of the medical oxygen cylinders. Right, you know, the researchers at the Indian Institute of Technology Roper have developed the first of its kind, the oxygen rationing device, which is known as the MLACs. So here, as you know, that once the people basically use, you know, the oxygen, specifically the oxygen mask, right, what they do is basically when they inhale, they also inhale the carbon dioxide also. At that point of the time, they also, you know, exhale basically the oxygen, which has been supplied by the oxygen cylinder. So MLACs basically supply the required amount of oxygen during the inhalation process only, and during exhalation, this oxygen supply basically trips down or stops down, right, during the patient's inhalation, and that will basically saves, you know, the huge amount of oxygen. Otherwise that oxygen will get wasted in that process. So that is basically very important and very significant, that during exhalation the oxygen, specifically the oxygen cylinders or the pipe, is pushed out along with the exhaled carbon dioxide, and with that device we can control this oxygen which have been released by the cylinder, right? So this device can be attached with the oxygen cylinder. Here the large volume of the oxygen which escapes from the opening of the mask along with the carbon dioxide will be saved, and 1000 tons of the oxygen will be saved, right, in between the inhalation and exhalation process due to the continuous flow of the life-saving gases in the mask. All right, that's all for today. Thank you very much. We'll meet again tomorrow for our next round of affairs. Thank you very much.